Alicorni. The Legend of Starlit Sky. By Portal Jumper. Part 3. Chapter 1, The City of Engines. Starlit awoke to the sound of birds chirping through her cracked window. A beam of warm sunlight hit her fur as she got out of bed, dispelling some of the early morning chills she was typically prone to on waking. With a few stretches she limbered her joints up before leaving the guest room Twilight had lent her to go and get breakfast. The last week and a half spent in Twilight's home had been cozy, but active. After Twilight had gotten Starlit's full debriefing from Sunspear in addition to setting Suns, she had come to the conclusion that Starlit needed better training with the weapons she would be given. Through a course of both training and knowledge implantation via magic, Starlit improved, and while she was no master swordsmare, she felt confident enough that she could handle herself. Starlit descended to the common room expecting to find Sun and Twilight setting up for another bout of training, but instead saw only Twilight hunkered over some scrolls at her table. "Are you going to be doing some exercises with Sun today?" Starlit asked. Twilight near leapt to her hooves when Starlit spoke, coming to meet her at the bottom of the stairs. She looked worried, far more so than Starlit had ever seen her. "Finally, you're awake," Twilight said. "Come with me, you need to see this."
"See what?"
Starlit asked as Twilight moved past her and ascended the stairs. Not receiving an answer, Starlit followed behind, clinging higher into the oak than she'd previously gone. Twilight got to the top of the stairs before Starlit did, and Starlit found that she'd opened a trap door that led up into the ceiling and to the outside. Taking care to not knock into the door, Starlit climbs up into the canopy of the tree. There was a large flat spot in the center of the canopy about the size of the common room downstairs, dominated by a massive device. It was cylindrical, made of blackened metal inlaid with silver, and was pointed out into the surrounding branches. Twilight was looking into an eyepiece near the ground floor, carefully adjusting a series of knives, levers, and cranks that moved the device's position. "Twilight, what's the matter?" Starlit asked. "Something that's moved our timetable ahead further than I'd prefer," Twilight answered. "Come, look into the telescope, you need to see this." Looking closer at the machine, Starlit could now see the similarities it had to the smaller telescope on the lower balcony that she had seen when first visiting the oak. With a hurried step, she approached it. The telescope's view in the eyepiece was crystal clear, and showed Starlit a familiar sight. When Twilight had shown her the vision of her battle with the other princesses, it had taken place in a massive fortress of some description. The view in the lens was of that fortress, and Starlit made the logical leap to assume that she was looking at Canterlit. The palace and city surrounding it had seen better days. Several towers were broken off, large sections of masonry and mortar were missing from the walls and buildings, and the polished alabaster and rich purples of the architecture were dull and lifeless where they weren't out and out stripped away or burned black. What drew Starlit's eye the most was what she assumed Twilight had meant to show her. From the tallest tower that still stood, its roof seemingly made of glass or crystal, a golden beam of energy pierced the sky. It illuminated large swathes of the city, bringing back a certain life and energy to the ruins it shone down on. It also made for a massive beacon, telling every pony what Starlit already knew: Celestia had returned to Canterlit. "I see the issue," Starlit quipped as she pulled away from the telescope. Twilight looked ready to burst from nerves. "Yes, the massive signal telling Luna, Cadence, and Chrysalis that Celestia has returned to Canterlit is a bit of an issue, Starlit," Twilight replied facetiously. "I was hoping to have more time to work with you, but this means that you and I both are now up against a countdown." "I'm not sure I follow," Starlit said. "Why would them knowing Celestia has gone back be a problem? If anything, it may convince them to come back as well, if only to investigate why she returned." "Starlit, I don't think you quite grasp just how much we all hated each other during and after the war," Twilight replied, pacing back and forth as she spoke. "When Canterlit fell and we scattered to the winds, it wasn't because we grew tired of the fighting, it was because we had exhausted our available armies. I'm certain that the others are just waiting for an excuse to reopen the hostilities, and this beacon gives them that excuse. So what do we do about this? Starlet asked. She already knew what the answer was, but wanted to hear Twilight say it. We need to make our play now, and that means you are going to need to go to Luna's domain, Twilight answered. New Selene was an industrial and manufacturing hub for the Old Kingdom, and if any pony is prepared to mount an invasion it would be her. Twilight beckoned Starlet to follow her back downstairs. Twilight mostly muttered to herself, going over plans within plans, which gave Starlet a bit of time to mull over her situation. She was confident enough at swordplay that she could potentially defeat an opponent in single combat, but if Twilight's understanding of Luna's automated forces had taught her anything, it's that she would be underprepared even if she had another few months of training. Furthermore, Sun was beginning to show signs of his weakening magic, where once he'd been able to hold a full-grown stallion in place for nearly a minute, he was now finding it difficult to do the same for 30 seconds to a relatively weak unicorn like herself. Twilight had done what she could for him, even giving some of her magic to him to help make up the difference, but the fact remained that he was going to get weaker and weaker. Starlet, are you listening? Twikinked asked, snapping Starlet out of her musings. What? Sorry, I was thinking, Starlet answered. There will be plenty of time for that later, but for right now we need to get you your equipment. Sun and Spike have been busy for a bit getting Sun's things prepared, and they've selected a few things for you to go over. Together they descended into the basement, where Starlet found Sun and Pike scurrying about. She also noted with some surprise that Spike was holding things despite being made of light as he bustled some provisions over to Sun's saddlebags. Oh good, you're here, Sun said as he noticed Starlet and Twilight. I was about to come and get you. Did Twilight give you the news? Yes, she did, Starlet answered. What have you gotten together? Basic things mostly, food, supplies for camping out, and a few guidebooks on New Selene from Twilight's libraries. Are you sure books are going to be necessary? Starlet asked as she began getting her weapons and gear together. They're almost certainly a few centuries out of date. It's better to have some information than none at all, Sun replied. Besides, I'm mostly using them for their maps and architectural notes. Unless Luna went to the trouble of reconfiguring her whole city during this whole time, there should be some use to these books. And if not, we could always use them as kindling, Starlet half-heartedly joked. No pony laughed, and Starlet noticed Twilight throw a withering glare at her from across the room. Starlet looked at her assembled gear, going over what she would and would not need. She had retrieved another small sword from Twilight's collection, this one with a proper crossguard at the handle. After seeing the ferocity of the Thestral's first hoof, she wanted something that could keep them at bay rather than let them run down the length of the blade and hilt to attack her. She had also been growing better in her aiming with her magic, so she brought along a bandolier with a few throwing knives in it. They wouldn't be her primary means of defense, but they would serve in a pinch. She decided not to take any armor since it would both reduce her mobility and, as was proven in her first death, wouldn't hold up to much damage anyway. Twilight had made a new set of saddlebags for her, made from hardened leather and with the clasps molded to look like her cutie mark, a wisp of magic encased in a warding circle. The metalwork was immaculate and shone in the blue torchlight of Twilight's lab. Quickly she put her provisions and whatever gear she could think to bring in the bags. Her stomach growled as all the excitement had made her skip breakfast, but she would make up for it later. Starlet heard the familiar hum of Twilight charging up her teleporter, but before she turned to face it, Sun tapped her on the shoulder. Starlet, could I talk with you for a moment? Is it urgent? Starlet asked back. Not particularly, but Sun began. Then save it for when we get settled on the other side, Starlet interjected. This device she's powering up is not kind, but once we have our bearings in Luna's city then we can talk. Fair. Sun kicked his hooves dejectedly, muttering an affirmative before gathering up his things and going over to the teleportation pad. Starlet hated having to brush him off so brusquely, but right now she needed to focus. Focus on settling herself down, as well as planning 5 steps ahead for whatever Luna might have waiting for them on the other side. Quickly she pulled her saddlebags on and slid her sword into its sheath, the weight of it comfortable against her hip. She had taken to always keeping the amulet on herself since she now understood its value, although she still detested its powers and hold on her. A crackle of energy from across the room told Starlet that the pad was ready, and she turned to find Sun already standing in it. The stone spikes covered in swirling glyphs sizzled with Twilight's magic, and Starlet took a moment to appreciate just how ominous they looked. The magical signature coming from New Selene is more focused than the one that came from Sun's pier, so I should be able to put the two of you out closer to the city, Twilight said as Starlet walked onto the pad. Could you do anything for the nausea? Starlet asked, because the last thing I want is to lose more of my stomach contents after already skipping breakfast. Possibly, but ultimately your ability to hold your dinner depends on your tolerance level. You've been through once before so it may not affect you as badly, but Sun is certainly going to be thrown for a loop. Starlet curtly nodded, hoping upon hope that Twilight's hypothesis was right. She turned to look at Sun, as he was breathing more heavily than normal. Starlet knew it was nerves, and she knew from experience that they were justified. Don't worry, Sun, you'll do fine, Starlet said. It's just some dizziness and an upset stomach, nothing to get worked up over. Speak for yourself, Sun answered. I had nausea problems as a colt, so I doubt being shot who knows how far across the world is going to do wonders for me. Starlet was about to give some more words of encouragement when she was distracted by a flash of purple light, followed by Twilight floating a pair of small candies towards herself and Sun. Here, they're medicinal, Twilight said. A combination of ginger and a few herbs that help with nausea and inner ear problems. This should get you through to the other side with no ill effect, but be forewarned that your balance is going to be spotty for the next hour or so. Starlet and Sun each took one of the candies, Sun having popped his in his mouth before Twilight had finished speaking. Figuring that a little less sure-hoofedness would be worth not vomiting, Starlet ate it as well. The candy was bitter with a heat to it that sat thick on her tongue, but all the best medicines she'd ever taken tasted foul. The spell should put you within a few miles of Luna's palace, Twilight continued. Somewhere in the lower districts of the city where ponies with actual authority shouldn't be able to see you appear. The only advice I can give you is to go up and avoid any pony that looks official. Thank you for your help, Your Highness, Sun blurted out. Sun, in all honesty, I should be the one thanking you. The two of you have already gone above and beyond my wildest expectations, and I couldn't be more appreciative. Stay safe. For all of our sakes. And in a flash of familiar purple light, Starlet and Sun vanished. Asterisk. A powerful stench of smoke and garbage filled Starlet's nostrils when her hooves found purchase, followed swiftly by the sound of Sun vomiting. Her own head felt like it had been beaten against a rock and she only barely avoided falling face first into a muddy gutter that ran through the cobblestone alley they had appeared in. Fortunately, despite the smell, Starlet was able to hold her dinner down. Oh. Twilight wasn't kidding, Sun moaned through a small burp. My brain feels like it got blended. I'd say that's about what it felt like the first time for me, Starlet replied as she staggered over to her companion. The hem of his cloak was drenched in gutter water and sick as he'd fallen over when they landed. With some effort Starlet hoisted him to his hooves. You all right? Starlet asked. Yeah, I'll be fine, just need to wait for the world to stop spinning, Sun answered as he held a hoof to his head. You go scout around, I'll stay in the nice, safe alley. With a pat on the shoulder Starlet turned to follow the alley. Even though it was daytime everything seemed unnaturally dark, like the sun was shining through layers of gauze. The walls of the alley were dull brick that neatly matched the cobblestones beneath her hooves. And along the walls a series of brass and copper pipes ran in frantic tangles. She could hear fluids and gases being pumped through them, leading to somewhere and from somewhere else. When she finally stumbled out into the street the twisting alley connected to Starlet found herself in a completely alien city. Sun's pier she could at least understand, with its opulence being made of stone and marble and other familiar materials. New Cellini, on the other hoof, was a city of steam and magic. Buildings belched smoke into the air from iron chimneys while flameless lamps illuminated the thoroughfare. Ponies milled about the street, selling wares Starlet had never seen and using devices she couldn't even begin to understand. Dominating her view of this new and somewhat terrifying city was a grand building far off in the distance. Its edifice formed a pyramidal silhouette, with towers connected by buttresses and bridges that ascended higher and higher until they came to a peak above the smoke-filled sky. The palace was resplendent with deep blue and silver stonework, in stark contrast to the slummy conditions on the street. "Looking for directions, miss?" an earth pony asked, causing Starlet to jump. He had been far too close for comfort and Starlet nearly skewered him with a throwing knife for startling her. "No, I'm fine, really," Starlet stammered. "I can make my own way, thank you." "You sure about that?" a Pegasus asked from behind her, again making Starlet jump but with a small shriek as well. The Pegasus gave her a wicked grin as she eyed her up and down. "Didn't any pony ever tell you not to sneak up on others?" "Can't say any pony did, no," the Pegasus answered. "That's a pretty necklace you've got on there. How much?" Starlet was taken aback by the brazenness of the Pegasus' offer, but was forced to suppress a laugh given the amount of times she'd tried to get rid of it. "If I could sell it to you I would, but I'm afraid I can't," Starlet answered as she sidled back from the Pegasus. She came to an abrupt stop when the earth pony that had initially startled her put himself between her and freedom. "Oh, anything can be bought and sold," he cooed in a way that chilled Starlet to her bones. Reflexively she drew her sword and jumped out toward the street, keeping it leveled at her assailants. "I don't want any trouble from you two, but this necklace isn't for sale. Now leave me be before you force me to do something we're all going to regret." The earth pony shied back a touch, but the Pegasus stayed still, her eyes scanning Starlet up and down like a predator about to pounce. Starlet and the Pegasus eyed each other for a few seconds that felt like an hour before they both heard the sound of a clanking march coming down the street. Starlet turned to look while the Pegasus and earth pony scattered with nary a word, and she soon understood why. A machine was making its way down the street, one unlike any she'd ever seen. Its pony-shaped shell looked to be made of copper or a material similar in color, and with every step it took a jet of steam burst out from the sides of its mouth. It walked with exacting precision, paying no heed to anything around itself as it moved. Its eyes were a solid teal, nearly the same shade as Starlet's eyes, and from the seams and joints in its armor she could see piping that glowed the same color. It slowed its march before coming to a full stop in the middle of the street. The vendors on the street had all hidden away in corners, alleys, and the buildings nearby when they had heard the machine coming, leaving Starlet as the sole witness to it. With a hiss of steam and burst of light from its horn, its head rose a few inches off of the base of its neck. It then rotated its head on a swivel around its neck joint, a sight that Starlet found more nauseating than the teleportation had been. Beams of light shot from its eyes as it scanned the shops and carts around it before stopping when it saw Starlet standing gobsmacked a few yards away from it. Its eyes shifted from teal to a sickly yellow as its head descended onto its neck and it resumed its march, this time towards Starlet. Quickly Starlet swung her sword around to face the machine, but it remained undaunted in its approach. "Unidentified unicorn, you are in violation of the ban on personal weapons for citizens class C and lower," the machine intoned, its canned voice flat and lifeless. "Please submit your weapons for summary destruction or you will be prosecuted." Starlet looked towards the alley, keeping her weapon raised as the machine stared at her. If she ran, she believed she could outpace it since it only seemed capable of marching in lockstep, and getting Sun into the mix could help her take care of it discreetly. Her amulet tugged towards the alley, further giving her reason to try and run. As swiftly as she'd been taught, Starlet sheathed her sword and booked it into the alley, but she barely got more than a few feet before she lost her balance and tripled, skidding to a halt and skinning her forehead. Quickly Starlet scrambled to face the machine to find its eyes now a dull red. She drew her sword as fast as she could, but the machine blasted it out of her magic with a shot from its horn as it stalked forward. The second shot it fired hit Starlet right between the eyes, and she was dead before she hit the cobblestones. Asterisk. Sun had begun to stumble after Starlet as soon as she rounded the corner that led further down the alley, but found the disorientation was too much for him to keep pace with her. He felt like it had taken a solid 5 minutes just to get to the alley's exit, and the sight he found there did not help his nausea. A machine in the shape of a pony was standing over Starlet's body, a fresh trail of smoke and the scent of charred fur and burnt meat telling him that she'd been killed for the third time. The machine's teal eyes were focused in the middle distance as it stood over her, and Sun quickly ducked behind a large nest of pipes in case it decided to look around. Minutes passed as Sun sat behind the pipes, waiting for the telltale sound of clanking hooves to tell him it was safe to leave. His nausea slowly receded while he waited, and he took some time to go over what he knew. New Selene was the most technologically advanced place he'd ever seen, that much was certain. He'd read about technology that ran off of magic from ages long past, such as his parents' brass shields, and the appearance of the machine seemed to indicate that it too ran off of some kind of magic. The only issue he could find was figuring out how the magic was being made. There was no giant magic emitter like Celestia's sun that he knew of, so it had to come from somewhere more discreet. Having some trouble, are we? A smooth, chilling voice said from nowhere and everywhere at once. Sun had to suppress a yelp of surprise and shock. Now, there's no need for hysterics, the voice continued. I am but your humble servant in this, a most arduous of tasks. Not wanting to give away his position, Sun thought back at the voice that, for all he knew, only he could hear. Who are you? Sun asked back. And furthermore, how did you get inside my head? Ooh, he's a quick learner, the voice said back. It sounded feminine, but there was enough distortion in its speech that it was hard to tell. I do know how to pick em, don't I? Don't break your leg patting yourself on the back, Sun snapped back. Answer the questions. That seems only fair, seeing as I've invaded your privacy and all that, the voice answered back. First the how, you had contact with a magical artifact of some description a week or so ago. Am I correct? Sun thought back to when he had fiddled with Starlet's amulet, and particularly the presence that had seemed to direct him towards certain visions and memories that he was still sorting through. You were in Starlet's amulet, weren't you? Sun answered. You showed me all of those visions. Very good, Sun, very good indeed. The voice replied condescendingly. As for the who, I'm afraid that is privileged information. Oh no, you don't get off that easily. Tell me who you are right now or you'll do what, exactly? The voice replied. Like it or not, we're stuck together until I decide I'm done with you. I hope you enjoy having a brain neighbor. Sun began to answer, but stopped when he realized that the voice was right. If this was connected to Starlet's amulet, then there really was no recourse he had against it short of killing himself to get rid of it. Even if he did, there was still the off chance that he would be revived by the amulet as well. Fine, you've got me in a corner, Sun replied, but can you at least give me something to call you? I don't think Starlet will take kindly to me referring to a brain neighbor without thinking I've gone insane. Give me some time to think of one, because right now you have bigger things to worry about, the voice said. Look past the pipes. Hesitantly, Sun poked his head past his hiding spot, and his heart dropped into the bricks beneath him when he saw what his new friend was referring to. Starlet and the machine were both gone.